Praise the Lord, brothers. Everybody have a good Saturday? Awesome. God is with us. Even his name, Emmanuel. God is with us. Hallelujah. Now you're praising. Now you're awake. His salvation is so amazing because I didn't deserve it. Who here thinks you deserve God's salvation? Good. Because you don't. And neither do I. Life's pathway. Jesus said He'd hold us in His hand. I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. He is great. Great is the Lord. He is holy and just. By His power we trust in His love. Great is the Lord. He is faithful and true. By His mercy He proves He is love. Praise the Lord. Right. But praise the Lord. He's worthy of praise. We need to surrender totally to Him. Our lives would go a lot easier. Yes, we'll still face our struggles. We'll still have trials. We'll still have troubles. But we'll go through them with joy. Because we know that it's not the end. That this isn't what it's about. That this stuff around us is all dying. But that which is eternal, we have in our hands. Joy, peace, love, His presence. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him. My blessed Savior, I surrender.
Could you just a second while I make check out the sound system?
Sure, absolutely. Okay. Definitely working. Amen. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I'd lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the Spirit. This is a Hebrew song that is translated to English, so I'll do both. Bo Ruach Elohim Umale et Nafshi Adre Hatanuk Yaladim Rabbe Hanu Chavetzim Anaknu hazminim ocha lavo. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come and fill us now. For you are welcome in this place. Show your mercy and your grace. Come and fill us, Holy Spirit, come. Baruch haba, Spirit of God. Oh, Ruach Elohim, umaleh et nafshi, adrech atanu k'yaladim, ram bechanu charetzim, nakdu hazmini bocha lavo.
It's not our word at all, it's your word. than it is to be a part of your spirit. We pray that that will be their experience this evening. Lord, we pray for other parts of the meeting that there will be no distractions, so that your name can be glorified. We thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I want to say another thank you to David, the young man at the piano, a real concert. But we also have some songs we'd like to sing, as well as David. He does an excellent job. But we want to sing from these song sheets. Each one of you, I think, should have one. Those who desire to sing. We're going to start with number 8. Number 8 on the back side. What a great
man
of Jesus. Number 8.
That was actually the next one in my mind, too.
Sometimes even in the sight of men. And God holds us accountable for that. He does. That's why he sent his son to bear the consequence of our sin for us, so that we don't have to do that. The last song we're going to sing is number 7. And it describes what I've been talking about. God in mercy sent us. And you know, mercy is something we don't deserve. God gives grace. That's something. Yeah. Grace is something we don't deserve. Grace is something that he gives us. We don't deserve that either. Number 7. God in mercy sent his son.
Speaker picks up radio waves.
Yeah. Then the Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Let's see. I'm going to stop there. We all know that in the next chapter of Genesis, chapter 3, we have the account of the downfall of Adam and Eve. They were warned, but they chose to listen to somebody else. And that's what usually gets us into trouble. God gives us a warning, but we listen to somebody else. Okay? The next one I'd like to look at is Sodom and Gomorrah in chapter 19. Sodom and Gomorrah, the account is found in chapter 18, excuse me. Chapter 8. Genesis chapter 18, and I'm going to read 18 through 20. Now this actually takes place before the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, but God has gotten word of the misdeeds, the wicked behavior, the wicked lifestyle of the people in those two cities. And we think they were down near the Dead Sea in Israel. Since Abraham shall surely become great and mighty nation, all nations of the earth shall be blessed by him. For I have known him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring Abraham what he has spoken to him. And the Lord said, because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because of their sin, and because their sin is very grave, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry against it that has come to me. And if not, I will know. Then the men turned away from there and went down to Sodom. But Abram still stood before the Lord, and Abraham came near and said, would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Ooh, that's a good question. Suppose there were 50 righteous within the city, would you also destroy the place and not spare it for the 50 righteous that are there? Far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. Far be it from you, shall not the judge of all earth do right? So in other words, Abraham is bargaining to spare the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. If you find 50, that's a reasonable number. We don't know how many people there were, but I think there are a lot more than that. Now, to make a long story short, Abraham argued downward from 50, 40, and so on down. He got down to 10. God, if you find 10 righteous men in Sodom and Gomorrah, will you spare the cities? But God could not find even 10. God had warned them. Lot was living there, and he was surely a testimony, but they didn't listen to him either. And so the cities were destroyed, but God had given them a warning. Now there's another warning found in, Genesis chapter 6, verses 9 through 18. Now this account is about a man by the name of Noah. Mm-hmm. Noah, his wife, his two sons, and their wives. Again, the people around them had turned away from God. They had rejected God, the very creator of this universe. They had rejected him. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generation. Noah walked with God. That's the key right there. He walked with God. You can't walk with God and get your eyes on the wickedness of the world. If you get your eyes on the wickedness of the world, you're not walking with God. See what I mean? And Noah begat three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And the earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. Does that sound familiar? Do we have violence today?
Yeah.
Oh boy. So God looked on the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And then the Lord said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Then God gives Noah the instructions on how to build the ark. This was sort of like a giant raft. And in it, God would spare the people. Now, there's something very interesting about this. How many humans went into the ark?
Eight.
Say it out loud.
Eight.
Now, that's very interesting. I have a photocopy of an article out of, I think the magazine was Answers in Genesis. It's put out by the Institute
for Creation Research.
And this article, back from a few years back, gives an interesting insight into an ancient culture that is still here today. The ancient Chinese pictograph, the written language, has four interesting words in that language. Four written words in ancient Chinese. The first one that I'm going to look at is the word create. This is a Chinese word for create. It has these parts to make up the word. Their right language, different symbols are put together to form a word. We use different letters to make a word, but they use different symbols. And the symbols found for the word create are these: walk, talk, living, dust, and man. That's the word for create. Isn't that interesting? Does that reflect the book of Genesis? I bet it does. The word garden has these parts. Let me see. My eyes are tearing, so I'm going to have to.
God bless the Lord.
This is a condition, part of its old age. You young people here don't get old. The word for garden has, let's see here, dust, breath, enclosure, a person, and person. How many people?
Two.
Interesting, isn't it? That's from an ancient Chinese word for garden. Now, if those were the only two words, we might say, well, it's just a coincidence. But when you get four words that reflect what the Bible says, that's very, very curious. You've got to pay attention to it. Now, my two favorite words are boat and flood. Can't be anything in there, right? Boat is vessel, eight, and people. That's an ancient Chinese word. What does that remind you of? The ark.
First boat ever built.
How about flood? Water, total, together, earth, and eight. Now, don't try to tell me that God doesn't give warnings. Right there in the ancient Chinese language. Of course, their government doesn't recognize anything about the Bible today, but that's too bad. Now, you might say, so what? That God is giving us warnings right this very day, because our time on this earth, and I don't mean just an old man like me, I mean you young people, your time on earth is growing short. There's going to come a catastrophe to this earth unlike anything that's ever happened before. And my question is, are you ready for that catastrophe? Because I believe the Bible teaches us that those who accept the Lord Jesus Christ are going to be taken out of this terrible time. And that's what we would want for you to do tonight. Turn your heart over to the Lord. Well, that's about all I have to say. So unless this, our brother Fred is going to sing a number, and then our brother Roger is going to bring a word from the Bible to you. And you better listen, because there will be a quiz on it afterwards.
I'd like to add a couple of scriptures to what Jim has shared before I sing this particular song.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Bible is a good commentary on itself. What's found in the Old Testament is oftentimes explained in the New, or additional information is given to us. And speaking of warning, God, of course, warned Noah, didn't he, at the flood. What he was going to do. He's going to destroy the earth with a flood because of the exceeding wickedness of people, growing wickedness. He knew, Noah knew. But what did Noah do as he was building that ark? Back in the New Testament, Peter writes this in his second letter, chapter 2, verse 5. Well, let's start with verse 4, put it in context. Again, it's a warning. For if God did not spare angels who sinned, and cast them down to hell, and deliver them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment. If he's willing to do that, and did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness.
That's right.
That's what I'm getting at.
Amen.
While that ark was being built, people would come up and begin to ask questions. What's going on? What are you doing, Noah? Tell them what they're doing, what he was doing, and begin to laugh at them. But he was a preacher of righteousness. He let them know why. That was God's warning to Noah. Noah knew from God. Noah passed it on to them. But they failed to heed the warning. And when the day came, God told Noah what to do. Animals, birds, insects, things that God wanted to preserve, moved into the ark. Noah didn't have to do a thing. God told them what to do. And they came. They went in the ark. And then God said, Noah, you get in the ark. And he did. And when Noah is inside, it says, God shut the door. The ark was ready. The people inside were ready. The people outside were not. But they had been warned. I'd like to share a song with you now about someone who was also warned, and he took heed. He came to Christ. And what a change there was in his life, all because of Christ's death on Calvary's cross.
Those who sit in darkness from the prison. As we look into the Word of God tonight, I'd like to start in the book of Mark. Most of my message tonight is going to be coming out of the book of Mark. And I want to start with this in Mark chapter 8, verse 27. It says, "Now Jesus and his disciples went out to the towns of Caesarea and Philippi. And on the road, he asked his disciples, saying to them, 'Who do men say that I am?' So they answered, 'John the Baptist, but some say Elijah, and others one of the prophets.' And he said to them, 'But who do you say that I am?'" That's a very, very important question that each and every one of us will have to answer one day. Who do you say that Jesus is? Is Jesus just someone who, when you hit your thumb or you run into a table with your shins, you cry out his name? Or you say that Jesus is your Savior, your Lord and Master? You know, the Bible tells us that one day every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now Jim made a joke about a quiz, but there are questions that I'm going to ask of you tonight. Questions that I can't answer. Questions that only you can answer for yourselves. And this is one of them. Who do you say Jesus is? We're going to look into a couple of things in the Bible, people who met Jesus, and how he changed their lives. And I'm going to start with a little backstory here. And this is also in the Gospel of Mark. Here we go. "Now they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was going before them, and they were amazed. And as they followed, they were afraid, and he took the 12 aside and began to tell them things that would happen to him. 'Behold, we are going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles. And they will mock him and scourge him and spit on him and kill him. And on the third day he will rise again.'" You know, not that long ago that we took time to remember the death of Jesus at the cross, and also his resurrection the third day. But here Jesus is telling his disciples, they're on the road, they've been traveling, and they're heading to Jerusalem for that divine appointment that only Jesus could fulfill. And then it says, "Now, as they came to Jericho, and as he went out with his disciples in a great multitude, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging." Bartimaeus, in the Jewish lexicon, Bar would mean son of Timaeus. Blind Bartimaeus sat by the road begging. We don't know exactly when he lost his sight or how long he had been blind. We don't know if he had heard about this Jesus of Nazareth. We don't know if he had heard about the man in the country, in the region of the Gadarenes, who was demon-possessed and bound by chains, and Jesus delivered him from his demons. We don't know.
We don't know.
If Bartimaeus had heard about the raising of the dead of the synagogue, of the ruler of the synagogue, we don't know if he had heard about the feeding of the people with the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes. Had he heard about the lame being healed and walking? Had he heard about other people who were blind being healed of their blindness. When I heard, I don't know for sure, but I heard it said that when you lose one of your senses, your other senses take on a greater meaning. I don't know that Bartimaeus could feel the multitudes as it walked towards him, or if he can hear the people as they talked about Jesus. But when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Son of David was a popular title for the coming Messiah. "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." It says, "Then many warned him to be quiet." Jim spoke a warning. If you want to follow Jesus, rest assured that there will be people who want to hold you back and keep you quiet. When they warned him to be quiet, it says Bartimaeus cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." So Jesus stood still and commanded him, saying, "Be of good cheer. Rise, he is calling you." Those who just a moment before were telling him to hush up, know your role, stay in your place, now they're saying, "The master has bid you to come." I love this part right here. After hearing that Jesus had called him to grant him an audience, it says, he threw aside his garment, his begging garment that he threw across, he threw it down. There's a passage in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if anyone be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed away, behold, all things have begun to. See, Bartimaeus, when he arose and he threw off that garment, he is leaving the old behind. And now he's got an audience with Jesus. He's still blind. He still can't see. So Jesus answered and says, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "Rabboni, that I may see, that I may receive my sight." Then Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the road. You see, Bartimaeus, not only did he get his physical sight restored to him, but his spiritual sight was also granted to him. Now I have a question for you tonight. Another question. Are you blind? Or do you just not see? Are you blind? Or have you shut your eyes and turned your head? Has the God of this age blinded your mind? Lest you believe and see the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. If you cry out to Jesus, I guarantee you he will hear you and answer. Please take a long look and cry out to Jesus for mercy, and he will hear. I want to talk about another man. This man, as Jesus made his triumphal entry soon after this encounter with Bartimaeus, he was a prisoner in a Roman cell. I don't know if he could hear the people crying out, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Son of David! Hosanna! Hosanna! Glory to God in the highest! Hosanna! Hosanna!
Hosanna!"
I wonder was about. I wonder if he got word of the events that was taking place that week. I wonder if he had heard the shouts from his prison cell. That he knew that the tables in the temple of the money changers were being overturned and they were being chased out. I don't know if he had heard about the betrayal for 30 pieces of silver. I don't know if he had heard about the kangaroo court as they came and they captured Jesus and took him prisoner and took him before the Sanhedrin and they paid or bought false witnesses to testimony against him. I don't know if he knew about the rebel rousers that the Pharisees had caused the crowd to stir up against him. You see, this man, his name was Barabbas. Bar, once again, son of Abbas, of the father. We don't know who his father was, just like Barabbas, who was the son of Timaeus. And I can relate to this guy, Barabbas, in more ways than one. You see, I never knew who my father was. My real father, my earthly father. I was most likely the product of my mother was a heroin addict. So I had fathers, plural. And I lived a life like this Barabbas. We're going to let's look a little bit into Barabbas here. It says that there was one named Barabbas who was chained with his fellow rebels. They had committed murder in the rebellion. Turning back now to the Gospel of Matthew. There is Barabbas. Picking it up in Matthew chapter 27, verse 15. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to releasing to the multitude one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus, who was called the Christ?" For he knew that they had handed him over because of envy. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent to him saying, "Have nothing to do with that just man, for I've suffered many things today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitudes that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. They did not want to give up their power. They could not see that the prophesied Messiah was in their midst. Because of the hardness of their hearts, their minds were blinded by the God of this age. The governor answered and said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "What then shall I do with Jesus who is called Christ?" They all said to him, "Let him be crucified." Pilate, the governor, says, "Why? What evil has he done?" No, this is Pilate, Pontius Pilate. If you read in the Gospel of John, that three times, when they had brought Jesus before Pilate 3 times, I find no fault in this man. But there was one point where Jesus and Pilate are having this face-to-face conversation. And Jesus won't answer him the way he wants to get answered. And Pilate says to him, "Don't you know that I have the power to release you?" Why didn't you release him, Pilate, if you had the power? Why didn't you release him?
Why?
Because the Jewish leaders of the day said they were going to switch him out to Caesar. He had the power, but Jesus looked right at him. Beaten by the blows. He'd already been scourged. He'd bloody, battered, bruised. He'd been spit upon, mocked. Says, "You have no power over me. The power that you have came from above, from the Father." When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, or rather that a tumult was rising, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. I am innocent of the blood of this just person." Let's go back a few minutes here to Barabbas, chained in that Roman cell. You would allow me a little leeway, please.
You Barabbas.
Barabbas. Locked away in his cell. He doesn't know the events that are going on right now. See, Barabbas knew he was guilty. Just as I knew I was guilty of my sins. Barabbas knew the punishment that was facing him. So as he's sitting in his cell, he can probably hear the multitude outside. "Barabbas! Barabbas! Barabbas!" And he's going, yeah, they're calling for him. They're calling for him. A few minutes later, Barabbas hears, "Crucify! Crucify! Crucify! Crucify!" Barabbas is probably sitting in the cell, chained and bound. "I'm a goner. I'm a goner. They're gonna crucify him." And if you can, just for a minute, I want you to imagine this. That if Barabbas is sitting in his cell, in comes the Roman jailer. Probably looked at Barabbas with a little disdain. Walks over to Barabbas, gets the key, unlocks the shackles and the chains that had held him there. Said, "Barabbas, you're free to go." Perhaps going, "What, are you kidding me, man? I'm free to go." "Yes, Barabbas, you're free to go. Somebody has taken your place." "Well, what are you talking about? That makes no sense. Who would take the place of a murderer, of a criminal who is set to be crucified?" "Barabbas, your penalty has been paid. Paid in full. Somebody else has taken your place." "Who? Who would take my place?" "I don't know, Barabbas. His name is Jesus. He's from Nazareth." "Where is he? Where can I find him?" "Barabbas, the last I heard, they were taking him up to the place of the skull. They were taking him up to be crucified." "Lord, thank you, Jesus. glory for Barabbas and his release from the condemnation is a parallel with everyone who gives their life to Christ. We stand deserving of our punishment. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 says, the wages, what we have earned, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. You see, Jesus, the Son of God, took the place of Barabbas, Son of the Father, just as he took our punishment upon himself at the cross. What happened to Barabbas after his release? The Bible and secular history give us no clue. But the choices available for Barabbas are available to us all. To surrender to God in grateful acknowledgement for what Christ has done for us at the cross. The Bible says one of my favorite verses from 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we may become the righteousness of God. You know, we have a choice tonight. We can spurn the gift that Jesus has given us, the gift of grace and mercy, and continue living apart from the Lord. One final scenario before I turn it over to Craig. What if the Roman soldier had went in there to release Barabbas from his chains and his shackles? And Barabbas said, no thanks, I'm good. No thanks, I'll just stay right here where I'm at. Doesn't make much sense, though. What chains are you bound by this evening? What are you a prisoner of tonight? It could be drugs. It could be alcohol. It just could be that things just haven't gone your way in life. I can relate to that. But tonight, Jesus wants to set you free.
Amen.
Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen.
Amen.
But,
I'm not sure I can add anything. Roger said, well, he said it all. The issue is, what are we about? The Lord Jesus Christ is here to release you from that bondage tonight. The choice is yours. What do you think about Barabbas? He posed the question. Suppose that Barabbas had refused. Why would he turn it down? We say that Barabbas is a fool. He had nothing to look forward to except death. That applies to you and me. If we go into eternity carrying our sins, the chains that bind us, what do we have opportunity to change? That opportunity is here tonight. As we open this evening, we pray to the Lord that He would speak to your heart through His Word. He has. I know He has to some of you here tonight. We're going to close. We're going to close in prayer. But we'll be here, and if you'd like to come and share with us your decision, or if you have a prayer request, we'll pray with you about it. Now remember what you've heard tonight. The warning that God always gives about what He's going to do. And the fact that He's done it. He has done it. The opportunity is yours. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You again for this group of folks who is here tonight. It's no accident that they're here.
In fact, you knew from eternity past exactly who would be here tonight, each and every one. Because there's a divine appointment possible tonight for someone here. I should make that plural. Because it can be for anyone and everyone. Who is outside of Christ. Lord, we just pray your heart, your spirit speaking to the hearts of men, that this would be the night when they would come to Christ. Even as blind Bartimaeus, he cast aside the thing that would prevent him from coming quickly, so that he could come to Christ. And Christ asks, what do you want me to do? Bartimaeus knew what his problem was, physically. And you, through your Holy Spirit, have brought home the fact that each one of us have a spiritual problem. A spiritual blindness, a spiritual burden, a spiritual bondage. That's what we want to be free of tonight. Our needs who come are coming in that asking for that. Lord, we pray that you move tonight. We pray this in Jesus' name.